She's one of the most amazing singer-songwriters and guitarists out of the 1970s, 80s, and today. Miss Lita Ford, how are we doing tonight?
I'm good. I'm doing great. Still rocking.
I know you are. I love it. And we're going to talk about all the new stuff that you're working on these days. But I know, Lita, you were born in London, England, and your family relocated over here to the States when you were a very young age. And what were you really digging on listening to when you were that young?
Oh, wow. When I was that young, I used to love the Monkees. They were my favorite band. I used to have a crush on Davy Jones. I thought, oh, Davy. And I would sit with the album cover and look at his picture. He was so cute. And then from there, it progressed on to bands like The Who, Jimi Hendrix, Black Sabbath. And I got into the heavier stuff. So they were really my favorite. Deep Purple, you know, Ritchie Blackmore, of course, was my idol. I think everybody knows that. But he was such a big influence on me and my guitar playing.
And Lita, how did you meet up with Kim Foley? How did that all happen?
Well, that's kind of a wacky story. I learned to play when I was 11. I started playing when I was 11. I got my first guitar. And by the time I was 13, I was actually pretty good. A couple of years, you know, playing, noodling around. I'd picked up on some cool licks and riffs and I was able to play. So a friend of mine's band had played, had a gig coming up. They were going to play, and their bass player pulled out, so they didn't have a bass player. They asked me to play bass for this one-off show that they were doing, and I said to them, I don't play bass. And they said, well, you do now. Lita, you're playing tonight. And I thought, oh, goody, okay. I don't even know the songs, let alone how to play bass. So I got up and I played bass for that one show. And word had gotten out that there was a female bass player, me, and it got to Kim Fowley. Word had gotten to Kim Fowley. So Kim Fowley calls me looking for a bass player. And I said to Kim, I don't play bass, Kim. And he says, well, what do you play? And I said, well, I play guitar. I'm a guitar player. And he said, oh, well, we need one of those, too. He gave me the rap of a lifetime that I couldn't refuse. And I ended up packing up my amp, packing up my guitar, driving up to North Hollywood, West Hollywood. It was West Hollywood. And we had this little rehearsal studio where the girls were auditioning band members. And so far, it was only Joan Jett and Sandy West. They had a bassist in mind they were going to use, who was Mickey Steele. But Mickey Steele was a little older. She didn't really like Kim. She didn't want to be in the band. I was the third member to join at that point, which was pretty cool. We bonded right away. It was a match made in heaven.
What was that experience like for you, Lita, for you know, going on tour with the girls of Runaways? And, I mean, what was that experience like for you personally?
Well, it was, I mean, we were kids. You know, we were just growing up. Our hormones were just kicking in. And it was tough. It was tough, but at the same time, it was exciting. We learned a lot. You know, I learned a lot. I learned a lot about the world and touring different countries and cultures and just the way, you know, things you would normally learn in a high school book, I actually got to live it and go there and play with the different currencies and, you know, the different languages, and it was awesome. And the audiences were insane because it was during the punk era. So it was a really great time to be in a rock band.
And I know the Runaways did soon break up, and you embarked on an amazing solo career, and Out of Blood album was released, and then the follow-up album, Dancing on the Edge. And how was the great tune Fire in My Heart discovered?
Fire in My Heart, wow. That was something I wrote. I didn't have any particular reason for writing that song. We were just goofing around and trying to come up with musical ideas and the Fire in My Heart. I know that's a lot of people's favorite song.
Yeah.
And no, it was just something that I wrote and put together.
And tell me the background story, Lita, on how you got signed to MCA Records by Sharon Osbourne, and how did that all come about?
Well, I actually had a record deal before Sharon was on board. Sharon was actually the last person I added to the mix at that point in that time in my career. I had a record deal. It was with through Dreamland Records, which was through RCA BMG Records. Dreamland was Mike Chapman's label.
Oh, okay.
So I had signed to Dreamland, and then Mike and I had thrown around some ideas of recording different songs. And then we brought Sharon on board because I had no manager at the time. And I wanted a female. I wanted a woman manager. I thought there's not very many woman managers out there. And I needed somebody who could relate to me because I'm a female as well. And Sharon was number one in my book at that time. I couldn't hurt to ask, so I gave her a call, and you know she could only say no. So thank God she accepted my proposal, and she was the icing on the cake for me. Put me on some great tours, and I loved her dearly.
And I always love the song, Lita, Kiss Me Deadly. I mean, it just fires off like it's in a cannon. And what's the background on Kiss Me Deadly? I love that song.
Kiss Me Deadly was brought in by Mike Chapman. It was actually written by Mick Smiley. And when he brought it in, it was a very slow version. And the key was lower. It was a lower register. So it was more of a, I went to a party last Saturday night.
Wow, really?
And
wow.
I said, Mike, let's speed it up. Let's raise the key so it's got some energy, mm-hmm. and it's more of a high pitch vocal range for me. And it rocked.
How did the song Close My Eyes Forever come about with Ozzy?
Sharon and Ozzy had came to the studio. We were recording, and I had just bought a new house, and Sharon had bought me a housewarming gift. They came to the studio, and they brought me this life-size duplicate of Coco the gorilla from the San Diego Zoo.
Nice.
It was literally as big as a real gorilla. I thought, how am I going to get this thing home? You know, it's huge. Ozzy and I had some wine, and we played pool, and Sharon got bored and left. Ozzy and I wrote Close My Eyes Forever. Next thing I know, the sun's coming up, and I'm driving home with Coco Gorilla strapped in the front seat of my Jeep. But we had a hit song.
I know there was a personal track called Lisa. And tell me the background on the tune Lisa.
Yeah, Lisa. Oh, boy. Well, Lisa was a song that I had written as a gift for my mother. My parents and I were very, very, very close. You know, we were really inseparable. I was an only child. My parents were my biggest fans. They were just the best. I was so blessed to have such great parents. And when my mother was diagnosed with breast cancer, she had been given so long to live, and I wanted to give her something before she passed away. You know, some people write songs after the person they love is gone or dead, and they never get to see or hear it, in the flesh anyway. Maybe in the spirit world they do, but I wanted to give her something that she could. She used to take it to chemotherapy, and she would sit there and get her chemo and watch the video and make all the doctors and nurses watch it. Everybody would say, oh, no, here comes Lisa again with that video. But it's a very touching song. And the actual photography in the video was taken by my father when I was a little girl. That's actually me in the video and my mother. It was taken on 8mm film. And then the video director, who was Wayne Isham, transferred the film onto onto a DVD, gave it a tint of color because it was in black and white.
Mm-hmm.
He gave it a little tint of color in places. He made it come to life, in other words, and he incorporated it into the video, which is genius.
Tell me, Lita, tell me about this new Christmas single.
Yeah, the Christmas single, that was something we started last year and couldn't get it together in time to release by Christmas because my old drummer, Roger Carter, had called and he said, Lita, let's go into my studio and record. And I said, record what? And he says, well, let's record a Christmas song. And he had in mind to record an already written Jingle Bells, Let It Snow, I don't know, I'll Be Home for Christmas, something that was already written. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to write something. And I felt like the world is ready for a new Christmas song, especially something rockin', because us rock and rollers, we don't want to hear Let It Snow and, you know, we want to listen to something rockin'. So at least I know I do, and I can speak for myself. So I wrote with Mitch Perry and my lyricist, Michael Dan Emig, the three of us wrote Rock This Christmas Down. It's smoking hot when it just came out. It was a godsend. It came out so great. And Cherie Curry had called me the day we were going in to record. And she says, I'm getting on a plane. I'm flying from Ohio to Los Angeles. I should be landing about 3 o'clock. And I said, wait a minute, you're landing at 3 o'clock? I said, you got the whole day ahead of you. You need to come from the LAX airport straight over to the studio and lay down a vocal track. And she says, what? Wait a minute, I don't know the song. I said, trust me, you'll be fine. So she did. She came straight from the studio, from the airport straight to the studio, put down her vocal track, and we left there later that night with Rock This Christmas Down.
Yeah.
And what a great time to reunite with an old friend.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure you guys had some good stories and some time to, you know, catch up, too.
Yeah. Yeah, we did. We had a lot of fun playing that and recording that song.
January 9th, Lita Ford's going to be performing live at the Whiskey A Go-Go in Hollywood. Plus, January 11th, she's going to be at M15 in Corona. For more information on Lita Ford, go to LitaFordOnline.com. Miss Lita Ford, thank you so very much. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.